Always thought that there is a massive information out there which frequently people don't bother looking at, which contains some really quite interesting and startling often pieces of analysis when you get down to it. It comes from looking at the otherwise potentially very dry UK defence statistics and listing various companies' turnovers, the sort of contracts they have with the Ministry of Defence. And I've done this analysis for about 9 years, not necessarily every year. This year, just suddenly noticed we are seeing a very steady rise in the amount of US companies' turnover in the UK. And then, when you look on a very conservative basis looking ahead, US company turnovers go higher and higher. To be fair, some of the companies do actually have relatively sizable presences in the UK market. And you think of, say, Lockheed Martin at Amptill, where they're doing the Warrior Capability Sustainment Program. Other US companies have, quite frankly, derisory UK presences, brass nameplate. And when they're winning these contracts, if 95% of those contracts go overseas, I'd be surprised. It's more like 98%. And you just have to ask yourself, what return, in every sense of the word, does the UK taxpayer get, the services get, let alone industry? And I think it is worrying that looking ahead, and I will defend my figures as conservative, and I bet the MOD can't provide anything to rebut this, you are seeing, especially with probable purchases of the P-8 Poseidon Maritime Patrol aircraft from Boeing, also a likely Apache upgrade from Boeing again, and a whole raft of other things, not least the deterrent, potentially up to £2.5 billion a year of about an £8 billion procurement budget going to US companies. And actually, the US company turnover, a lot of that is going to be offshore with no direct return to the UK of any type, and also then no future for maintenance, upgrades, or future platforms. If you're looking for a strategy for defence industry, there isn't one. And despite several white papers being published, the last time there was a coherent strategy was the 2005 Defence White Paper, which was overseen by Lord Drayson, the Defence Procurement Minister. And if anyone wants to know what a proper strategy looks like, they should go back and read it. Despite the fact that almost every Defence Procurement Minister since 2005 has said, no longer relevant, we'll have to write a new one, they're wrong. Lord Drayson did actually understand, as an industrialist, what he was writing about, and all of his assumptions about what you have to do still stand today. What I find fascinating and worrying is the UK thus must be not only the only major defence player in the world not to have an industrial strategy, we're probably about the only country without an industrial strategy for defence. You can look around Europe and look to countries, you know, I don't want to be disparaging, but Belgium and say Denmark, neither of which have massive defence industries, to put it mildly. But on almost every procurement they do, they will always seek to say, well, we have these niches. What can this money do for our industries? The US companies seem to understand this, that it is a prerequisite for entering those markets. And they will go out of their way to make sure that these Belgian companies, these Danish companies, get a slice of the action. For some reason, this doesn't happen over here. I would like to see people inside the Ministry of Defence and the Defence Equipment and Support branch actually being formally tasked, which there's a sort of dotted line, but formally tasked, and say, look, you have got to look at the true cost of equipment. They are meant to look at whole life costs of equipment. You can tell they are not doing that. It is possible to have a successful defence industrial strategy because a lot of other countries have got them. Interestingly enough, look to a country like Australia. They basically took the bare bones of the UK's 2005 defence industrial strategy, and they still think it works. They hold up defence purchases to some very, very simple metrics of what does it do for Australia. Why this shouldn't be the case in the UK, beggars belief. All you have to start saying is, alongside technical matters, capability matters, which you can rank equipment against each other, you just say one of the ones is, and so what for UK industry? Can UK industry play a role? If the answer is yes, then you have another metric of how does this procurement, if we go for system X, how does this play to UK industry? If it's more expensive, why does everyone else do it? Everyone else does it because it makes sense and they know it brings value for the taxpayer, it brings value for their armed forces, and it brings value for the broader country as a whole. If you don't end up finding some way for British industry to have a significant role, please note that, then that capability, which may exist today, will wither within 2 years. And when you then come to the next stage of a programme, the upgrades, things like that, there will be no technical base able to handle the upgrade. So where will the upgrade happen? Back out in the States. Again, it becomes a vicious circle. And one of the problems is it's always upfront cost and through life cost. And upfront, they can often provide a few figures here or there that suggest things are cheaper. Where they will never provide the data because they can't is through life costs. And there is no real recognition of this inside the MOD. Or if anyone does recognise this, they are just basically told to shut up and go away. And in theory as well, as part of the 2015 Strategic Defence and Security Review, there is a re-stressed commitment to defence exports. Well, let's be perfectly honest, if you don't actually make anything, you can't export it. So how there is meant to be this emphasis on defence exports when the people who are doing procurement are actively making sure we can't do this, beats me. Time and time again, people stating, oh yes, this is the better product. So why? And I have to say the only reason I can put down some of this prejudice is it's far nicer to go over to the States than it is to go up to Leicester, Yeovil, or Preston. If, for the sake of argument, significant elements of your combat air fleet all get maintained in the United States, and Britain were to get involved in some conflict which the US did not approve of, you would find very, very quickly that your US maintained aircraft, which you sent over there to be maintained, are just not being sent back. You would find that the spare parts you expected to arrive are just not coming over the Atlantic. To have any degree of freedom of action sovereignty, you have to make sure onshore you have a capability to be able to manage the equipment you use. Explain why we're still doing it over in San Antonio. It can't be explained on economics. What is wrong with any party supporting British Armed Forces being well equipped and well supported? I honestly cannot see that as a problem. If then that is also leading to the fact there are jobs onshore, which I think you can point out is necessary if you are to have proper defence, I can't see that as politically particularly difficult one or coloured blue or red. I think that's a no-brainer all round. Technologies which are very much of heading towards dual use and as much use to peace support operations, often disaster relief type events. Think of Lifesaver, who make water bottles that are able to filter the dirtiest water into clean water in about 20 minutes. Well, started off as a program for military special forces. It's now selling to relief agencies. There has been a massive growth in that type of technology. Yes, if you can diversify and you can get perhaps a more balanced industrial base and so forth, do it. But if someone is then suggesting to destroy what you've got before you diversify, I don't really see the point of that. That will lead to loss of jobs, loss of skills, and higher unemployment. If you look at the skill base of British defence industry, there is an incredibly good skill base. It is why on some other programmes, other countries come to us for help, advice, cooperative development, and so forth. Absolutely, there is a very, very good skill base. And it's worth bearing in mind, if you look at apprenticeships, two of the companies with the largest intake of engineering apprentices, I think they may be the two largest in the UK, is BAE Systems and Babcock. Now, you know, there is a future, and there can be a very good future. Necessity, pressure, has made British industry actually incredibly efficient, because they've had to be. They are not feather-bedded. But it's now increasingly a case of not only not being feather-bedded, but they're almost being punished for being effective and efficient. If you look at aspects of the defence industry, it has been recognised that defence isn't an industry like others. You can't just go out and, for the sake of argument, buy a tank as if you're buying a minibus. It's not that type of market. There are some very special high-tech areas which, if you want them, you've got to pay for them and then support them. We do still have a shipbuilding strategy for warships, and there's meant to be a refresher on that. So someone has recognised that without that, things go badly wrong. But for some reason, on a broader canvas, there doesn't seem to be that joined up government. Having a decent, proper, simple defence industrial strategy, that's an open goal. There are so many examples of defence industrial strategies around the world, not least countries like Sweden, Netherlands, Australia, which have got excellent strategies, a lot of them actually based on the 2005 strategy we had in this country, because it was so well written. These are open goals. And you have to ask yourself again, if this, having a defence industrial strategy is so bad, so stupid, so expensive, such a waste of time, why does everyone else have one? You can see the problem about joined up thinking on defence industrial matters by the fact that Defence Diversification Agency gets scrapped. The Centre for Defence Excellence, it means well. But the problem is when you start saying, hey, there's a great British company with a little product, it gets no traction in the procurement chain at all. And these are just symptoms that you can have people within the MOD or within UKTI who believe this is important. They get no traction inside the Ministry of Defence. At the end of the day, industry will want to make money, want to make profits. If they're not making it in the defence area and they know they can make it on the commercial aerospace side, they will swap production. And that is what a lot of companies which have got a balanced portfolio between defence and commercial, they do that every day, every week. It is doable if you have got the will and you're willing just to hold some very simple rulers up against procurement. And if there is a future for British defence industry, it's got some of the highest tech, decent equipment, it is in demand around the world, good revenues from a lot of users. Why shouldn't that continue? There's no reason why it shouldn't if you have a government of whatever hue that is willing to provide just some very simple support. But you then just require that little joined up government bit that says, yes, industry will invest, and they are investing in the manpower, in the training, in the skills. But at the end of the day, if the MOD is just saying, nah, we prefer flying off to the States, then there's no pipeline. Joined up government, joined up procurement, it doesn't take much at all. So anytime someone in services says, oh, it's much more effective to maintain in the States, I always say how on earth they work that one out, because it's just not true. And if you were to look at, say, BAE support to Typhoon, if you look at August Western support for Apache and Lynx Wildcat, that's just two examples. Babcock support for warships. It is world-class, and it is world-class cost-effective.